Hello, everyone. Welcome to People on Dating. I'm your host, Will Morales. And on today's show, I have Kate Dudzik. Did I even get your last name close? Oh, perfect.
You did.
So she's a cognitive scientist, idea enthusiast, and a caffeinated writer, which is the best lines I ever heard. Her work as a scientist and author is fueled by her passion for exploring what it means to think, what thoughts look like, and where they come from, and what they mean. Kate, thank you so much for being on People on Dating. How are you?
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Will. I'm excited to be here. I'm doing well. How are you today?
I am good. So for those of you tuning in for the first time, this is a topic-based conversation about the ups and downs of dating, courtships. Whether you're 18 or 80, you have a story to tell. And the gist of this podcast really is just a conversation, no judgment. So, Kate, how did you get into this space? What was it about, let's say, cognitive scientists and things like that that you wanted to learn about, I guess, people surrounding you, if that makes any sense at all?
So how did I become interested in people, really?
Yeah, exactly. The short answer or the short question.
As a lifelong human, I have found myself surrounded by people. And honestly, when I was looking into what I wanted to do with my life, my passion kept coming back to thoughts, human nature, and even quite honestly, philosophy, where there was a time when I could have seen myself going more down that road. Mm-hmm. So I think kind of learning about where thoughts come from, why they happen the way they do, and everything that comes with that mixed bag of confusing tricks is kind of what led me here. And so since I've been searching for answers ever since, I'm still very much in the field. I think very much curiosity driven.
You know, people, when you see Kate, she looks no older than 2021. I mean, my gosh, she said we had a pre-discussion and she started at 2014. So I asked her, did you start when you were like 10, 12 years old? Because my God, you look so young. So anyway, that's another show. So today's topic is about online dating profiles. So early on, Kate, what did you see about the online dating profiles? And I got to admit, I've been on online, but I got off because I thought, I knew for some reason, if a woman got in contact with me and I got in contact with them, and I try to reach, let's talk on the phone, or, you know, their preference was texting and stuff like that. So I was a little leery about that. So I figured something must be wrong. Maybe I'm getting catfished. All of a sudden, this new phrase that I've been hearing for the last, you know, couple of years. So talk more about the online dating profiles and all that, because this is, to me, a very interesting subject to touch on.
Well, I think you raise a really important point there, and it's about representation of the self. Mm-hmm. When you build a profile, you're writing about you. So not only are you writing about what you believe to be true of you, hopefully, but you're also writing it in a way that is meant to show somebody something else. You know, Davidson talks about something called speaker-hear dynamics, where when you're the speaker, you have a responsibility to say your thoughts in a way that your audience, your hearer, can understand. And then the hearer kind of goes through these stages where you're going to try to find the proper meaning for what I'm saying based off of what you know about me or where I'm coming from. So when we talk about dating profiles, you're talking about constructing almost like a sales pitch about you, for the purpose of finding a hookup or a romantic partner, or maybe that date that spurs your story of romance for the rest of your days. And I mean, everyone has a different motivation going into this. So I'm sure, as you know, when you have a purpose to write something, it's gonna change the way that you get your point across. If you're talking about what you do for a living at the dinner table with family, it's going to come out a whole lot different than when you're talking about your colleagues in the field and you're geeking out about some things you're passionate about using terms that you all know, you all understand, right? So we've got a few different things going on there just in writing the bio alone. Then we've got the flip side too, where you're playing the almost Sherlock Holmes character, trying to read through these bios or these profiles, or quite honestly, let's get real. When people use technology, they use different types of reading strategies than they would if it's on paper or in front of them. So you've got people skimming, maybe flipping between Tinder and their emails. You know, you don't necessarily have a full, genuine attention on what's in front of you. So that's going to impact your skills as a hearer, really, for being able to understand what that person is trying to get across.
Right, right. I love that. So I think too, Kate, maybe are we as men, or if you're looking for a partner, whether just, you know, you're a man or a woman, are we looking just at the picture alone, and then just whether we're on Match.com or Tinder or any of those sites? If we look, let's say Match.com, because I was on that, and I was on another one called Our Time. We look at the pictures and we rarely read the bio. Is it because sometimes the bio might be a little too long for our reading comprehension or our attention span, so to speak, and we just look at the picture and maybe read a couple of lines and I said, oh, that's not for us or not for me. And you can see if Kate is laughing because I think she knows what I mean. Is that a legitimate excuse for someone just to swipe right or left or go to the next one? Because we're not even, I admit, I don't even read the whole bio. And I'm at fault at that when I was online. Is it a way that we could catch someone's attention by what we write? Is that possible? Or is it just the picture and then that's it?
I think there's a lot of different approaches to online dating. You know, for example, a lot of people believe they can tell about someone's personality from their photos. You know, a lot of dating experts will be like, okay, these are the types of photos you should post. One with your friends, one with you smiling, full teeth, one with you doing something hobby or interest related to show them it's your character. And I think a lot of people really do gravitate towards visual representations of information. So that even comes through in dating profiles where you're like, oh, am I getting a good vibe from this picture? But I mean, personally, I don't find myself very photogenic. 10 times out of 10, I'm just like, oh, I look so good in the mirror. What happened? Oh my goodness. And it's like, I can't get those angles right. Or maybe it's something about how comfortable I am in front of a camera. But regardless, there's a lot of people who will, for better and worse, put filters on, shift that angle, try to get something accentuated through that photograph. But again, we come back to speaker-hearer dynamics. They're trying to attract a certain type of person, and you're looking for a certain type of person as well. So when you're skimming through those pictures, you're trying to get a sense of who that person is just from their visual representation of what they're giving you to go off. Right. I mean, I think it says something about your headspace when you didn't really want to read those bios. And there's something called the halo effect, which is a cognitive bias. So that's almost like a flaw in judgment or decision making that we humans can do sometimes, where we rely on a heuristic or a bias to help us discern information in front of us. And the halo effect is when you've got kind of a negative view on the experience as a whole.
I'm guilty as charged.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at, friend. And you're not alone. I mean, a lot of people go, oh, online dating is such a slog. I need to flip through all these superficial people or whatever X, Y, and Z you think. And it does impact how well you're going to receive that information, because you've already got this half decision in your head that everyone on there is something or another that you decide for them without letting them be themselves or represent themselves the way that they want you to see. So you kind of take that away from the experience for everybody.
Right. No. I listen, like I said, I'm guilty as charged. So is there, like, what would you suggest for someone that, let's say, like for me, I told you, you know, when we talked off camera, I wasn't a fan of it because I would reach out to someone, or they'll reach out to me, I reach out back, and then there was no third reach back. So I realized, I'm like, am I wasting my time on this? And I did get a lot of hits and all that, which, and I did what you suggested, which is weird, because I did put pictures of me when I was younger. At the time, this is a few years ago, with me playing baseball, with me like roller skating, me a picture in a suit and tie, you know, so I definitely tried to expand the pictures. Yeah, so you get it.
You're right, I really get it.
Yeah, so Again, I want to go back to the to our biography that we put up, right? Like you said, we're representing ourselves. Is there a way, if you were to start your own online match company, which I think I got a feeling you'll be great at it for some reason. I really do. So, how was that?
I said, oh, you flatter me.
No, I really believe it because you to me, you have the science down. Is there a way that maybe is that a biography can catch us? Maybe we read about the person first and then see a picture second? I don't know, like reverse the process. I don't know if that even makes sense because the first thing we look at, everybody looks at is a picture. I mean, I saw something on YouTube where some women were looking at Tinder and they found 80% of the men not attractive. And I was like, Jesus, I mean, you eliminate like, you know, 3/4 of the population there, more than that. What would you suggest? I mean, because it's hard because I know people that are online and I feel like they strike out just as much as I did, you know? I mean, so go ahead.
No, you raised a couple really cool points in there. For one, you said it was a few years ago and the culture around digital behavior was really different then. And I know it's only been a few years, but you and I both know having an online presence is almost required now. Yeah. Versus back in like 2013, 2014, when it was still somewhat optional, you know, you didn't really have to represent yourself online, but now it is everything. There are so many people who have jobs that rely on being online and being on social and all this good stuff. So culture around online dating too has also changed, where even if you are dating out in the physical world, chances are you've got an online profile as well, especially demographic depending. You know, a lot of younger people have to have an online profile if they're going to be considered a good match. And this kind of moves well into your second point, which is first impressions. When you go up to somebody at a public place, maybe a coffee shop, and you strike up a conversation, you know, you exchange a few laughs and smiles, you are going off of physical appearance.
Right.
And there are some deciding factors for a lot of people in that. And now I agree with the thought of having almost like a love is blind approach. You kind of get to know the person first before making that judgment, because the environment that we meet somebody, online or offline, subconsciously influences how we're going to perceive them.
Right.
And I want you to think about the person that you may meet in line at, I don't know, a Starbucks.
Right.
To somebody that you meet at an art gallery. The environment alone is already going to shape your initial conversation. Wow. It's already going to shape the way you bring up topics or what you think you know about that person based off of assumption and personal experience in the past with other conversations in similar environments. So we take this principle of human behavior and then translate it into the online world. When you are meeting someone in an online dating space, what you think about that space and the people you're going to find there is already going to influence some of the ways that you think about that person before they get the chance to speak.
Wow, that's that. You know what? I never thought about it that way. excuse me. We talked with Kate Dudzik of, and our topic is online dating profiles. You know what, Kate? You hit it right on the head. If I'm in a Starbucks or if I'm in a grocery store, yes, the conversation will be a little different. You know, I go to a lot of networking events, so it'll be mostly business related topics or whatever where I'm at. Or if I go to singles events, it'll be, you know, the inevitable first question is, what do you do? You know, it seems like that never changes. Yeah. Wherever you are, whether you're in business or in a setting. So the environment is pretty much is the key to whether or not a conversation could go forward. And tell me if I'm wrong, whether it's again at a Starbucks or at a networking event, because again, do you think it depends on the actual person that's there? You know, if I'm at a networking event, especially business, are we talking about maybe again another new term, a higher value female or a higher value male? Would that play into how we might view the person that we're talking to? Did I make sense at all?
Yeah, that makes sense. So I'm just going to clarify it. The environment doesn't depict whether or not the conversation will go forward. I think a lot of it is personal compatibility and how that conversation goes. But it definitely plays a huge role in how that conversation starts, feelings about that person going into it, and almost like a baseline of where what you think you know about this person already.
Right.
When you're at a networking event, especially when it's business related, you already know that that person knows enough about that field to be there. Chances are they're going to have a name tag or maybe a title, or maybe you've heard of them through the grapevine or through friends of friends or through their work or publications. That might give you some insight into what they enjoy or what they're good at. Or oftentimes people who work as engineers are really good problem solvers. Maybe they enjoy problem solving, you know, different things like this almost give us like a commercial or a trailer for like our subconscious to kind of go into the conversation versus a coffee shop where it may be more casual, vague. You don't know anything going into it. They could be a librarian. They could be a teacher. They could be a scientist. They could be anything. You have their clothing. You have maybe their stature, their posture. Implicitly, we get vibes from people. This is usually from body cues, even the tone of their voice. Give us just a little implicit, like, ooh, that person seems light and easygoing, or ooh, that person is not having a good day. I'm going to take two steps backwards. You know, we get these cues. So when we look at online dating and whether or not that conversation is going to go forward, a lot of it comes from genuine connection. One of the good things about online dating is it's almost like everyone gets like this text bubble above their head.
Like plastic. That's true. You're right about that. Yes.
When you're looking at a profile, you get to see, dope, this person loves video games. I'm going to ask them what their favorite game is and maybe make a pun about a classic like Super Mario or something like that. Like maybe they know that, you know, The Legend of Zelda is really about being Link, and I'm excited about this. So, you have almost like an in to build that real connection if you see it and if you leverage it.
And you read it, and you read the bio.
A little important.
My God, that's, you know, I love that, because you're talking about trying to connect with like-minded people. Like when I go to these networking events, and I mean, it's dominated by men. I mean, there could be 100 people, like 85 are men, and you see some women there and all that. So would you suggest, or let me change it to, if I can suggest, if we're looking online, should we look at the bio where someone, like you said just before, they're into video games or they're into sports or whatever, and that might be a match, because at least you have something in common that you could at least start a conversation or throw in a pun here or there. And Kate, I never thought about it that way. You know, I will look at the picture, and I will look at I will read a little bit of the bio and then just move forward. But I love what you said, because it makes sense. It's just trying to find some commonality there that you guys can move forward, or at least the man or whoever's making the first move could go forward.
Yeah. And you know, what's funny is I feel like a lot of people, especially if you've been dating for a long time, you almost get wrapped up in finding somebody or finding that date, when really you almost need to take a step back and ask yourself, why am I here? What am I really looking for? And in a lot of ways, a lot of people are more interested in getting those matches than they are with getting the right kinds of matches. And this goes for whatever your motivation may be. Even if you're looking for, pardon my language, even if you're looking for a fuck buddy, or if you're looking for a casual dating relationship where sometimes if you're in town, or if you're looking for a more stable long-term partner with a genuine love connection, whatever it may be that you're looking for in another person, knowing that going in and being clear with yourself, because if you're not looking for genuine connection, you don't need to bond over your hobbies. But if you
Right.
are, why wouldn't you make sure you could bond? Why wouldn't you find a partner who loves to do the same types of things in their free time as you? Or maybe not everything, but enough to make that beautiful friendship, which is really, even statistically, the most valuable part of a successful romantic relationship, that friend bond, you know?
Yeah, that's always the key is, having the friend bond first. You have the good chemistry, and then from there it could grow. So I like what you said. Why are we there? You know,
yeah.
Are we looking, or why are you online?
Yeah.
You know, if Tinder is supposed to be, like I said, a hookup, then you're there, like you said, for F buddy. Or if you're going to, whether, you know, for anybody that's over 50, our time or match.com, what's the reason why you're there? I love that. And then again, you bring so many new things to light for me, because like I said, I was so against online dating because I just, and I won't even say a bad experience. It's just not reconnecting. If you connect with me, I connect with you. Well, then let's go forward. And I think too, Kate, a lot of times where I would try to initiate a conversation over the phone, I would get, oh, that's too soon. Oh, we don't even know each other, but, maybe they thought I might be a stalker and just keep on calling their phone number. Listen, I could take a hint. If someone doesn't like me, I'm out of there. That's it. I don't need no closure. Going forward, for anyone that when they listen to this show, what would you suggest that they do? In other words, I know you touched that already, but maybe one or two simple steps that they could at least start with online dating profiles. Let's start with their own. Like how would you suggest they start their own? I know you said multiple pictures. How about the actual bio when you put it in text?
Yeah, great question. And I think you raise a couple of great points there too, where it's like almost shed your past experience with online dating and try to keep a refresh perspective, almost like you're trying something new. Okay, we're walking into this. Chapter two, next phase, you know?
Yeah.
We leveled up. Okay. So when you're writing your bio, again, it really does come to what is motivating you to be here and write that point. Anyone you match with is going to want to be on the same page with you, or you won't have that in-person date that comes from it.
Mm-hmm.
So write your bio to what you're looking for. And I'm not saying you need to be like looking specifically to get married and have 3.5 children hug. And maybe that's your cup of tea and maybe you want to write that and that's cool. But also leaving it more open. So if you're writing for a superficial connection, making it superficial, making it just humorous or with some sexual innuendos or something like that. But if you're looking for something more genuine, write about your genuine self. You know, do you love to kick back on a Friday night with some pizza and beer, playing Pong with your friends? Or are you more of the type to wake up early on a Sunday morning to feel the crisp air as you run through the trails behind your house? What is genuine about you that someone can speak to and kind of build that bond through light conversation? Maybe they love trail running too. And you can both kind of bond over, oh, it sucks doing those morning drives that once you get there, you know, that's where the real stuff comes in. Because even if you're at a bar, if you're just telling someone, oh, yeah, I do this. Yeah, cool. Why? Oh, cool. You like this bit. And, like, find something to bond over. Do you love the music? Do you love the vibe? Are you here because they have pinball in the back and you can play with your buddies sometimes? Those are the personal parts, not the, oh, you like gin and tonic, me too, yay, you know?
Yeah, no, to me the key of this topic is just to find something to bond over.
Yeah.
Among other things, but I love that because that's like to me a tweetable quote right there. Find something to bond over. Mm-hmm. First of all, Kate, I really appreciate you being on People on Dating. My god, this again, you woke me up, and I definitely appreciate that, because at least you're giving me a second thought, you know, not to give up on online dating, because, you know, obviously with the pandemic and everything. What's next for you? What are you looking to do in the next 3 to 6 months? What's in Kate's crystal ball?
Well, considering I just finished writing the chapter on online dating for my book, finishing that is my number one goal. I am writing a book about mental health in the digital age.
Wow.
So Oh yeah, it is a party. It's also something that as a scientist, but also as a human being, I am so passionate about because as we spoke about a bit earlier, tech isn't optional anymore.
No, it's part of our lives. Yeah.
So we got to stop pretending that you can just, oh, put down the cell phone to improve your mental health. No, friend, like that is not an option anymore. So what can we do about it? How can we be equipped to live our best lives with technology instead of pretending that it's just like a toy or a passing fad? Because it's not, it's here. How can we make it better?
Right. Oh, wow. So when you're gonna have this book available, is
I
it
promise I will let you know as soon as I do.
okay? No, because I definitely want to put it on the show notes. Any other books you would recommend for people to look at or to read or things like that?
Honestly, learn about yourself.
Okay.
Find a book that calls to you and helps you better understand yourself, the world you live in, and maybe helps you become more comfortable with some of the uncomfortable parts of being human. One of the best pieces of advice I ever got was from my advisor and back in grad school, Dr. West. He told me to kind of sit with negative feelings because they tell us the most about ourselves and what we're going through. They're the most honest. It's easy to overlook happiness or joy or inspiration because it's such a welcomed feeling. But when you sit with almost anxiety or the feeling of wanting, what is that saying about you? And kind of lean into it instead of stuffing it down because that's going to grow into a whole bunch of mental health problems to unpack with your therapist.
Yeah,
So,
you'll be there for hours.
yeah, that would be my best piece of advice is don't look at being single and dating as a chore or something wrong with you. It's not. It's an opportunity to get
Well,
to know
you, yeah, and you're interviewing someone anyway. You look at it that way.
exactly.
You're getting to interview
Are.
them, and then from there you'll decide, yeah, I want to see this person again or not. Anything that I might have forgotten to ask you that you could think about, like any classes you might be given in the future, any courses that you might think about doing? Because one, I was definitely gonna say you have a book in you. Two, you definitely have coaching that you, if you're not doing it now, you better do it because you have so much to offer all of us. So I really believe that. So anything I might have forgotten to touch base on, you think?
My heart is going into my book right now, but you've inspired me. Maybe coaching's on the horizon. I feel like that would be a great time to speak with experts like yourself too, and connect with people about these really important parts of our lives that give us meaning and hope. So,
Yeah, I just think
okay.
too, yo, no, definitely. Listen, you have so much to offer
Oh,
all of
yeah.
us, and I really believe that you should, I can't wait for your book to come out so I could definitely publicize it and then get it. And if somebody want to get in contact with you, what's the best way?
Through my website, it's cognitivekate.com, or you can find me on LinkedIn for a professional sense. I am around and I'm always happy to help out as best as I can if I've got the time and capacity.
No, definitely. Listen, you gave us so many golden nuggets. If you saw my head always going down because I was writing notes. I mean, I had half a page, but my God, I couldn't write so fast because you were giving me so many golden nuggets. Well, anyway,
Flatter
hey,
me.
no, listen, Kate, first of all, thank you so much for being on People on Dating. I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me, Will. It's such a pleasure to talk to you. You have a great energy, and I'm looking forward to our next chat.
Yes, folks, we're going to have a second chat probably next month, I'm assuming, or whenever Kate's available. Kate's a busy person. So, and I think we're talking about being empowered after becoming single, right? That's our
That's
next topic with us. Yeah. So tune in for that. Anyway, Kate, again, thank you so much. I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Will. It's been a pleasure.
My pleasure too. Thank you. Well, everyone, that was Kate Dudzik, and you can find her at cognitivekate.com. That's cognitivekate.com. Kate, thank you so much for being on People on Dating. Really appreciate it. You can find me at peopleondating.com. That's peopleondating.com. You can also find me on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. Please go to Apple Podcasts. Please subscribe, leave a review. Tell us how we can make the show better or come up with a topic that you want to talk about. Anyway, guys. Oh, and on our website, check out our past shows, check out our blog, and eventually I'll have a resource page. Anyway, guys, I want to thank you so much for listening. On behalf of People on Dating, I'm Will Morales. Until next time, thanks, everybody. Have a great day, and please stay safe. Bye.